Good morning, everyone. My name is Brandon. I'm one of the pastors here at Legacy. Whether you're joining us online, on television, or right here in the sanctuary, we're glad you decided to spend just a little bit of your Sunday with us. We've been exploring how to reignite the passion for our faith, because passion in all areas of our lives wanes over time. We've been trying to revive that passion in us through the life of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement. We've seen already up to this point that revival begins in us. Revival begins by cultivating a humble spirit, perseverance through all things, and an investment in the children and students under our care. We found in the storms in our life, Jesus walks with us through it all. We lean into the storms with Jesus, and we find God is with us through it all. We saw in John Wesley's college years that his passionate pursuit for holiness, this pursuit to live more like Jesus today than yesterday, ends up helping all of us to satisfy our deepest longings for purpose, for love, for joy, and for hope. Today, Wesley's legalistic and rigid framework for faith finally gets the needed adjustment, finally gets the needed balance, as he finally sees the necessity of grace. Now, grace is one of those, can be another one of those churchy words that loses their meaning over time. It can mean both everything and nothing all at once. So we're going to try to restore some of the power of grace today. At the most basic level, grace is getting what you do not deserve. Grace is getting what you do not deserve. You didn't do anything for it. You didn't earn it. It's given to you as a free gift. It is pure, unmerited favor. When I was nearing the end of seminary, of graduate school, Vicki and I received the news that one of our loans that we had was paid off by somebody else completely. It was gone, entirely forgiven. Done. It was nothing I did. It was nothing Vicki did. It was simply wiped off of our record. And we were ecstatic. We were elated. We received a gift of grace. Jean Valjean, he was a thief and a criminal. He stayed the night, welcomed into the home of a bishop, and during the night, he stole all of the bishop's silver and assaulted that bishop. Now, this was one of Liam Neeson's pre-action hero roles. Liam Neeson actually did act in things other than action films. In this film, this is what happens to Jean Valjean after he assaults and robs this bishop. Watch this.
So we'll use wooden spoons.
I don't want to hear anything more about it.
I'm sorry to disturb you.
You caught him.
But I had my eye on this man.
Oh, thank God.
I'm very angry with you, Jean Valjean.
What happened to your eye, Monseigneur?
Didn't he tell you he was our guest last night?
Oh, yes. After we searched his knapsack and found all this silver, he claimed that you gave it to him.
Yes. Of course I gave him the silverware. But why didn't you take the candlesticks? That was very foolish. Madame Gillot, fetch the silver candlesticks. They're worth at least 2,000 francs. Why did you leave them? Hurry. Monsieur Valjean has to get going. He's lost a lot of time. Did you forget to take them?
Are you saying he told us the truth?
Of course. Thank you for bringing him back. I'm very relieved.
Release him.
You're really letting me go?
Didn't you understand the bishop?
Madame Gillot, offer these men some wine. They must be thirsty.
Thank you.
Don't forget. Don't ever forget. You've promised to become a new man.
Promise? Why are you doing this?
Jean Valjean, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I've bought your soul. I've ransomed you from fear and hatred. And now I give you back to God.
He did not deserve a second chance. His behavior did not show a second chance. But despite all of that, that's what he received. He did not get what he deserved. Friends, that's grace. All of us, every human being that has ever lived, that lives now and will live, is affected by God's grace from the womb to the tomb. I love this definition. Grace is God's unconditional love for all creation. Grace is the reality that there is nothing you can do to make God love you more, and there is nothing you can do to make God love you less. Say that with me. It'll be on the screen for us. Grace is the reality that there is nothing you can do to make God love you more, and there is nothing you can do to make God love you less. Do you believe that this morning? Grace is central to the character of God. Our scripture today is one of the most famous passages on grace written by Paul, a first century church planter and missionary. His letter focuses upon salvation through Jesus as a gift. We didn't do anything to earn it. We merely accept the gift of salvation through Jesus as a gift of God's grace, God's unmerited favor for all of humanity. Grace is an absolutely fundamental concept in following Jesus, and it is central to a Methodist understanding of this faith. We're going to pick it up in the short letter of Ephesians. It's in the back part of your Bible. We're going to start in chapter 2 with verse 8. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not from yourselves. It is a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, John Wesley preached from this passage no less than 40 different times. He went to it over and over and over again. He knew this passage in his head, but by the time he had a failed missionary journey here in America and he went back to England in Aldersgate Street, this passage made its way from his head into his heart. Wesley finally understood that he was saved not by anything that he did, but by what Jesus did, this free gift of God's grace. He didn't have to do anything to earn it. He merely needed to live his life in thanks to that gift and seek to live a little bit more like Jesus today than he did the day before. Grace, as Paul uses it, it's an act of kindness, an expression of selfless love that is completely undeserved and given without any expectation of repayment. You don't owe anything for it. We are never more like God than when we're selflessly giving to others. Because God created us to live in this way, we seldom feel more alive or we feel more joyful than when we're serving and blessing and helping someone else. That is grace. Now, Paul has two distinct uses of grace, even in these three verses. First, grace is a quality of God's character. God loves, blesses, and forgives humanity despite all of our shortcomings, all of our failures, all of our sins. Grace is central to God's character. Second, grace is God's active work by the Spirit to draw us to God and to restore us, to redeem us, to change us, to transform us, to be what God knows we can be. You know, we can see both of these active in these three verses we read this morning. Verse 8 is that grace, we've been saved by faith. It's God's gift to us. No one can boast. This is central to who God is. But we're not just given that free gift and it's over. We're not just given that gift and we're done. No, we are saved, we're redeemed, we're healed, we're restored for a purpose. We're here to do the good works God has for us in the world. We're to do the things God has equipped and made us able to do and through our passions. You know, grace is central to one of God's main qualities, but some of us don't conceive of God like that. Some people have this picture of God as an angry judge or a judgmental parent who is never satisfied, who is just waiting for us to mess up so that God can send us to hell. Now, whenever we have thoughts like this, you've got to check them with Jesus. You've got to check them with Jesus, who God in the flesh, who walked our earth and breathed our air. What was Jesus' understanding of God? Jesus said, God is a shepherd searching for a lost sheep. God is a father who runs to meet his wayward child. God is a friend of drunkards and prostitutes and every other person who misses the mark. God is gracious and merciful. God feels compassion and great love for God's children. Jesus paints a picture far from the angry, judgmental God that some people have in their heads. Our very existence is the result of God's grace. Every good thing in our lives is, in an ultimate sense, a reflection of God's grace. And so we respond to that free gift with worship and praise and a life full of gratitude. Now, not only is God's character reflected in grace, but we see grace as God's active work in us. God is constantly trying to influence us, to woo us, to begin a connection with Jesus. God wants to transform us. God wants us to be the versions of ourselves that look and act and think and behave like Jesus were us. In order to do that, in order to be that, we've got to be aware of sin and in our lives and in the world. Now, in the New Testament, the word sin usually means missing the mark or straying from the path. We're walking away from God's best in our lives. In Scripture, sin is also a force that can work inside of us to pull us off that same path. We know, driving the highways and the interstates here in North Dakota, we know that any windy day makes it difficult for us to stay on the path. There are many days we're driving down the interstate and your steering wheel's at like 45 degrees, approaching 90 and 180, just to keep the thing on the interstate. We know if we didn't turn our steering wheel, we would let go, immediately find ourselves in the other lane, or worse, in the ditch. The wind is always trying to push us off of the path. Friends, that is the effect of sin in our life. That's the effect of sin in us pulling us off the path that God wants us to be on. We've all felt this pull away and out of God's reach. Paul, in a different letter, he puts it like this. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, am I not really the one doing wrong? It is sin living in me that does it. To counter the pull of sin in our lives, the grace of God's active work through the Spirit is needed. We need that grace transforming us. So after John Wesley's heart strangely warmed experience, after that free gift of grace finally made its way from his head into his heart, he developed these different movements of grace that we live in our lives. And so today, the question for us is, which one of these movements we're going to look at? Where are you at today? Which movement of grace are you living in? God has designed us to keep taking steps forward, to keep moving deeper into that amazing grace of Jesus. So what next step can you take down this grace that is freely given to us as a gift, and this grace that is given to restore us to all that God has made us to be? The first movement of grace is prevenient grace. And Wesley used the metaphor of a house to help us understand this. Prevenient grace is the porch of God's house. Everybody starts on this porch of God's house. Prevenient grace is the grace that comes before we say Jesus is Lord in our lives. Prevenient grace is what comes even before we even know there is a God at all. You know, this is the porch of God's house, and here today, we don't really have many porches on our homes anymore, but the parsonage that we live in still does. Vicky and I enjoy the porch. We ended up buying new furniture at Costco because that's what you do when you're at Costco. You go buy normal food stuff, and they're like, oh, we need some lawn furniture, so we'll buy, you know, lawn furniture. But we love to sit out there, and we enjoy watching the summer storms roll in, or in the case of the last couple of weeks, watching these freak windstorms kind of come through and blow through the neighborhoods. Prevenient grace is the porch. It's the entryway. It's what happens before we surrender our lives to Jesus. This grace surrounds us all the time in creation itself. It's the love we experience from family and friends. It's in Christian community. It's whenever we feel joy or happiness or guilt or shame. God is constantly wanting everyone, every single person on the planet, to move off of the porch and to walk into the house of God's grace. Friends, God is working on us even before we conceptualize there is a God in the world. Prevenient grace is one of the reasons we perform infant baptisms. We acknowledge God is already working in and around the life of the infant and with the hopes they're going to follow Jesus later in their life. God is working around us all the time, urging us, wanting us to begin a relationship with Jesus so we can impact the world for Jesus as God has designed us to do. Now, in 1980, a young woman shared with her friends in the break room at her work that the adoption for her child had fallen through. So she's talking to her friends in this break room. She said loudly, for really no one in particular to hear, "Does anyone want a baby?" And a hand goes up across the room, and this woman says, "I do." And that woman was my aunt. She knew my parents were looking to adopt, and as a result of a random break room encounter in Indiana, where my aunt raised her hand, I end up with my parents here in Bismarck, North Dakota, in early 1981. That's a story of prevenient grace in my life. God is moving around us all of the time, even if we don't acknowledge that God exists. So friends, are you in prevenient grace today? Are you on the porch? You haven't said, "Yes, Jesus, you are my Lord." Lots and lots of people get stuck here. Lots and lots of people stay on the porch. There is so much more. There is so much more inside of the house God wants you to experience. The porch is just the beginning. Perhaps your next step today, perhaps your next step is to cross the threshold to walk into the door of the life of a Christian. Because that second movement of grace is saving grace or justifying grace. It's the doorway of the home. This is when we say yes to following Jesus with our whole lives. We accept everything Christ has done to make us right with God. And we have assurance. We know we're made right in God's eyes because of it. You know, John Wesley, to help people make this decision, he engaged in a practice he thought was absolutely inappropriate. No pastor should ever do this. He engaged in field preaching, literally going out to the fields and preaching a sermon to whoever was there. John was trained as an Anglican priest, so he knew worship only happened inside the four walls of a church with pews, with an organ, and a pulpit that was like 10 feet off the ground because that's where they were back in his day. That's how he was trained. That's how church happened. However, he couldn't deny all these other pastors preaching and getting incredible responses from people. So he wrote in one journal, "At 4 p.m, I submitted to be more vile and proclaimed in the highways the glad tidings of salvation to about 3,000 people. I submitted to be more vile." I do like old English. "I submitted to be more vile, to exercise, to eat broccoli, to drink more water, to go to bed on time. It wasn't something I wanted to do, but it was good for me anyway." Well, this was not his favorite method of ministry, at least at the beginning. He couldn't argue. He couldn't argue with these lives being changed. And there's a lesson in there for us. Sometimes it takes us doing something before we really see the value of it. Sometimes our favorite things were not our favorite at first, and we're never going to know until we try. Do you remember the very first time you said yes to Jesus? For some of us, it might be not yet, but it could be today. For many, choosing to follow Jesus, it happens like this dimmer switch that many of us have in our homes. The decision to cross the doorway, to move from the porch into the house, it's an awakening process over months or years or decades. We might grow up going to church, we go along with emotions, until one day we realize we have never really said yes to Jesus. We've never really said, "Okay, Jesus, you are the Lord of my life." So it's much like that dimmer switch where the light of Jesus slowly gets turned on in our life. Now for others, it's a regular switch. It goes from dark to blasting light in an instant. Our cat Leo has taken to napping in our bedroom, so when I walk into the room to change clothes, I flip on the light, and all of a sudden I've got this grumpy cat looking back at me like, "What are you doing? I'm trying to take a nap." It's really blast. It's a fast change. Happens in an instant. You know, there are still people today, when they follow Jesus, they change in an instant. It is that quick conversion. They seemingly change overnight, and you notice they changed, and they tell you, they met Jesus. They became a Christian. That absolutely still happens. The blinding white light overnight conversion still happens in the world. But for the vast majority of us, we came to Jesus as a dimmer switch. We're all dimmer switch people. We kick the tree, kick the tires. We check things out. We go, come to it slowly. We do our homework, and then we decide, you know what? I do want to make Jesus the Lord of my life. I was a dimmer switch person. I grew up in the church, surrounded by kids ministry, student ministry, other great adult examples of what it looks like to follow Jesus in normal, ordinary, everyday life. It was at a high school youth rally at a conference that the light finally came to full blast in me. I knew I needed Jesus in my life, and so I accepted Christ and chose to pattern my life after him in all things to the best of my ability. That's when I stepped off the porch. That's when I stepped into the doorway and accepted God's relentlessly loving pursuit of me. So is it time for you today? Is it time for you today to come off the porch into the entryway of the house and to say yes? To say yes, whatever, what God wants to do in your life. The third movement of grace, it's sanctifying grace. It's this lifelong journey where we come into the house and we move from room to room with Jesus and we start changing our behaviors, our attitudes to match his. We can get stuck so easily in saving grace. We can get stuck on the porch. We can get stuck in the doorway. We get stuck in the doorway and we stay there and we don't move on. We've punched our ticket for heaven. We accepted the new birth in Jesus and we literally stay right there standing in the doorway of all the rest God has got for us. But there is so much more. We don't have cable at our house, and the one thing I miss is late-night infomercials. The five-stack food dehydrator you didn't know you needed because you don't dry food. That knife that can cut through cans and through because you all need a backup option in case all your other can openers break down. The juicer that will purify anything from fruit to aluminum cans, because who doesn't need that? Or the vacuum cleaner that's going to help you pick up all those pesky bowling balls that you left laying all around your house. Every single infomercial has that, wait, there's more, moment in it, giving you another dehydrator or a knife or a vacuum for the same awesomely low price. Friends, sanctifying grace is God's, wait, there's more, moment. Saving grace is not the end of the story. We can wrongly assume the Christian life is all about getting to heaven when it is about this lifelong adventure of letting God love us so God can get more of heaven into us that we can spread into the world. Following Jesus is not just a ticket to go to heaven, but a lifelong process of becoming a fully mature and grown-up disciple of Jesus Christ. Friends, there is only one new birth. There's only one time you walk into the house. But there are multiple conversions in our lives. There are multiple things God's going to change in us. As we move from apathy to love, as we go from despair to joy, and from closed fists to generosity, God's grace and love not only provides us a way to get to heaven someday, to be made right with God, but also to shape us and to change us right now. John Wesley used the term the means of grace to open us up to all the different conversions God wants to do in us, all the different transformations. These are practices like worship and scripture reading, like fasting and prayer. Those are the means where we let God's grace come into us and start to do these multiple conversions God wants to do in us. The means of grace open us up, make us more grateful to others, and help us be our true selves as we serve others with a unique mix of passions and gifts and talents. Sanctifying grace is what we experience as we seek to love God with everything that we are, as we seek to love ourselves with everything that we are, and as we seek to love others with everything we are. Just as we connect with our friends and family as on a daily basis, we talk with them, it has got to be the same with God. The only way we get to know God is to spend daily, focused time with God. So often the struggles in our spiritual lives come down to this question. When was the last time you spent time with God? Has it been ages since you prayed, been in a life group or a class, worship, or Christian community? It should not surprise us we feel far from God when we stop doing the very things that help us feel close to God. Just like when we feel far away from our family or friends, when we don't connect, we feel the same as we do not connect with God. This is a quote from another author that has stuck with me for many years. This author wrote, "If you cannot tell me what God has been doing in your life in the last 30 days, I question whether or not you have a relationship with God." If you cannot tell me what God has been doing in your life in the last 30 days, I question whether you have a relationship with God. Well, that is direct and hits you right upside the head where it matters, right? Yes, it is great you had an experience with God years ago when you were in high school. Yes, that camp experience was amazing when you were a young adult. Yes, that sermon that impacted you a couple years ago was great. But what about today? What about last week? What about the last 30 days? The Holy Spirit wants to move in your life today. God is still speaking into our lives today. Are we listening to what God is challenging and urging us to do? What is God teaching you? Where is God healing you? When we are fully pursuing the means of grace, we can easily answer that question of what God has been doing in our lives lately. So, where are you today? Are you on the porch of prevenient grace? Are you in the doorway with saving grace? Are you moving room to room with God with sanctifying grace? Wherever you place yourself today, wherever you are, the Holy Spirit wants to take you to the next step. Move from the porch to the house by saying, "Yes, Jesus, you are my Lord." Move from the entryway to the other rooms through the means of grace to open yourself up to the multiple conversions God wants to do in your life. And as you do so, you will engage in the good works that God has skilled and gifted you and you alone to do. So friends, open the gift. Open the gift of God's grace and take the next step. Answer the call to serve others. Let's pray together. Loving God, we are daily grateful for the gift of your Son. We didn't do anything. We didn't do anything to earn his love and sacrifice for us. You simply gave him to us as a free gift. So may we humbly accept that gift and do all that we can to live our lives every single moment in thankfulness for your Son. May we live fully into your grace in our lives so we can be poured out in service to others through our passions, our gifts, and our talents. Those things you've placed in us. As we prepare to receive Holy Communion, a tangible reminder of the grace you've given us, we confess we've fallen short. We've not loved you with our whole heart. We've not loved our neighbors as ourselves. So in this moment of silent prayer, we bring to you our shortcomings, our failures, our sins from the week that was. May your Holy Spirit help us to stay on the road that leads to abundant life in your Son this week. We lift up all the prayers spoken and unspoken to you. And we pray together in the way Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying together, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."